Now for a reading of Isaiah 55, 3 through 13. Give ear and come to me. Listen, that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commander of the peoples. Surely you will summon nations you know not, and nations you do not know will come running to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from your mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will groan the juniper, and instead of briars the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will endure forever. Now will you join me in our congregational prayer? Careful. Is everything okay? Go on. Our God, we thank you for being with us today as we gather to reflect on your will for us and all creation. We thank you for being with Pastor Barbara this Sunday as she participates in her ordination at 4 p.m. We acknowledge your station in our lives as being paramount, and we are consoled by you when we feel discouraged. We are your people, God, and although we have countless reasons to celebrate the power of your word, we often get discouraged, be that because we don't see the immediate fruits of our labor or we see within ourselves perennial weeds that we thought we'd overcome. Weeds that, like thinking that material resources can ever make us happy or content, feeling inadequate, deprived, or needy when we see our neighbor's successes. We think that we have overcome and permanently removed these weeds, but they come back to us time and time again. These things make us tired. They make us tired because we have tried to do it all on our own. However, we are reminded today that we can rely on your word. We can stand like a tree planted by the streams of your living water. Help us find our strength, our comfort, and our satisfaction in you. Purge from our hearts rocky ground and or thorns and thistles so that the Holy Spirit will have fertile ground to grow love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We are reminded by the parable of the sower that we carry a huge responsibility for spreading the good news in our time. Gird us up in your strength and do your work in love and kindness. Help us to accomplish what you desire in and through us. Help us to achieve the purpose that you have set before us. For we are your hands and feet, and you are the power that sustains us. In God's name, amen. Now will you join us in singing, if you are able to stand in.
I wanna be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep. Unmovable and unshakable in you. I want to be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep. Unmovable and unshakable in you. I want to be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep. Unmovable and unshakable in you. I want to be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep. Unmovable and unshakable in you.
And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water. And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water. And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water. And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water.
This will be my song, God. This will be my prayer till the end, till the end. This will be my song, God.
This will be my prayer till the end, till the end.
This will be my song.
This
God.
Will be my song, God.
This will be my
prayer. This will be my prayer till the end, till the end.
This will be my song, God.
This will be my prayer till the end, till the end. And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water. And I want to be like a tree planted by the streams of living water.
I want to be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep.
Unmovable and unshakable in you.
I want to be unmovable and unshakable, so let my roots go down deep. Unmovable and unshakable in you. Please be seated as we welcome up Reverend Levermont.
Good evening. The scripture, as you know, this evening is taken from the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to Matthew. Please give reverent attention as I read this word. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in a parable, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil. And they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched. Since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Then later Jesus explains the parable because the disciples didn't understand. Here's what he said. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while, and when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. And as what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. Here ends the reading of God's word. Would you pray with me? And now, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, this evening it's very important that you understand that God always empowers and energizes his word. Always, without exception. During the year 1990 and 91, Desert Shield and Desert Storm, I, as a chaplain, received military orders to leave Fort Drum, New York, on a one-year hardship separation tour of duty. I was being reassigned to what would soon become the combat zone in the Republic of Turkey. I will never forget how stressful this was for me and my family. You see, I left for Turkey on Father's Day. I sadly left my wife and two children at a small airstrip in Watertown, New York, and flew 5,453 miles to the ancient city of Istanbul. My new unit was the 528th U.S. Army Artillery Group, headquartered in Çakmaklı, about 40 kilometers from Istanbul. And as that unit's chaplain, I was briefed that the unit's soldiers were scattered in five small detachments, 1,800 miles throughout that country. Once a month, sometimes with the Catholic priest, I would conduct pastoral visits to each detachment. Often, I would stay several days conducting divine worship, pastoral counseling, and various moral leadership training, concentrating on life skills that address the needs of isolated soldiers very far from home. I would usually travel by car, by military car, and the back of the license plate, can you believe it, in the combat zone, there was a license plate that said very clearly, USA. Sometimes I would travel over 1,000 miles by Turkish commercial THY Airlines. Now remember that, THY. The GIs derisively named the Turkish Airlines, they hate you, airlines. GIs have a very twisted sense of humor sometimes. In a car one day, heading to a remote outpost, I saw a sight I will never forget. A lone Turkish farmer was sowing seed in his immense field. I observed, as we were driving around the field perimeter, that there was a flicking technique, a real flicking technique to sow that seed in that field. That guy knew what he was doing. I kind of wondered if this low-tech method was really all that efficient. I thought immediately of Jesus' parable of the sower. I also wondered if this farmer ever got discouraged with his crop yield. The biblical context that Doug indicated on Sunday, the scriptures immediately prior to this parable, I think, are important. You might remember, if you were there or you heard his message, that right before he tells the parable of the sower, he is told by the disciples that his mother, his brothers, and his sisters are there waiting for him. They want to talk to him. And what does Jesus say? It's a rather puzzling thing. He says this, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" Jesus says to his disciples, "Here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of my Father in heaven, that person is my brother, sister, and mother. Whoever does the will of my Father is my mother, brothers, and sister." That means us, if we do the will of the Father. So, why did Jesus tell this story of the parable of the sower? Doug emphasized the good soil, the soil of the heart, the good soil of the heart. I would like to take a little different tact, and here's what I would like to suggest to you. Could it also be that Jesus was preparing these 12 men for a very tough and discouraging time to follow? You might remember there was only one disciple that died a natural death out of the 12. John was the only one. Every single other disciple was martyred for Jesus Christ's sake. And I believe that Jesus, one of the reasons why he told this parable was to in some way have them understand what they were going to be facing as they sowed the seeds of the Word of God throughout the world. I wonder if you have ever read the little tiny book called Screwtape Letters. I would like you to remember that if you've never read that. Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis. I would like you to remember that. Satan is giving instructions to one of his demons in that book. And Satan says to one of his demons about discouragement, "Discouragement is more useful to me than all the other tools I will give you. I can pry open and get inside a man's heart with that when I cannot get near him with any other tool. It is badly worn because I use it on almost everyone, since so few people know it belongs to me." Discouragement. If you're discouraged this evening, discouragement is a tool that Satan will often use on us. I have been discouraged. I have been ordained. 8 days ago, I celebrated my 46th anniversary of ordination. You're getting ready for your ordination council. 46 years ago, I can hardly believe it. My first two churches, one was in Alaska, and one as a staff person in Carson City, Nevada, were very discouraging to me. My first two churches. Why? We had to leave Alaska 2 weeks shy of 3 years because Audrey, my wife, was experiencing tremendous medical problems. We didn't get any doctor up there. only a public health nurse, and she was kind of useless. I'm serious. She was useless. My second church in Carson City, Nevada, we were there 18 months. We left that church because of some serious disagreement that I had, particularly, actually Audrey too, with the senior pastor. He's the senior pastor, the younger pastor has got to go, and I did. But when I went into the Army, I had also some discouragement because I was in isolated fields, I was serving people all over the known creation, and it was lonely. I served 20 years in 5 civilian pastorates, 24 years in 9 different Army units, etc., etc. We've experienced tremendous blessing in our ministries. Wherever we went, wherever we sowed the seeds of God's word, people responded. There was one lady that responded to faith. She became a Christian when she was taking a shower. She was saved in a shower and baptized all at the same time. And it was a marvelous experience. We've experienced tremendous blessing sowing the word of God. There are many pastors that get discouraged. Did you know what the average size of a church is in the United States? 84 adults. 84 adults. And sometimes pastors get very discouraged. Sometimes they feel they're at the breaking point. They're on call 24/7. They expect significant conflict in their church. Their role as a pastor is often overwhelming. And many pastors in smaller churches are very concerned about finances. They have no idea how they're going to finance their children's education, much less anything else. And it's very discouraging often, and I have been discouraged. But thanks be to God, He is always blessed. When that scripture was read a minute ago from Isaiah 55, it is absolutely true. Whenever God's word goes forth, always, 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 God blesses. There is no exception. Now, there's often times when I don't see the blessing. I may not know what God is going to do, but let me tell you something. He always does some amazing things. In over 40 years of ministry, I have learned the real life lessons about how the parable of the sower applies to believers. Now, before you leave tonight, I'm going to teach you a way to remember the parable of the sower. I want you to repeat after me. Find it. Flick it. Forget about it. Find it. What's the second one? Flick it. Forget about it. The ministry that God has for you is an amazing thing. You may not even know what it is right now. But I can tell you right now, God has got something for you. He knows the groups you belong to. He knows what you do with your spare time. He knows what you do in your retirement. The hobbies you have, the things that you enjoy. That is your mission field. Find your mission field. The second thing is, flick it. That Turkish farmer had a real technique. He grabbed stuff out of his bag, the seeds out of his bag, and he flicked it. And it's an amazing thing. He was so accurate. He flicked it with a wrist. Flicked it with a wrist. And the seeds were sown exactly where he wanted them to be sown. So find your field. Flick those seeds of the Word of God, the encouraging love of God. Flick it wherever you are. And then lastly, forget about it. Now let me clarify what I mean by that. I don't mean you forget about the people. You pray for those people. You pray for the situations in which you find yourself. But you do not get in the way of the Spirit of God. You let the Holy Spirit do what He is best at, convicting the hearts of men and women, boys and girls, find your field, flick the seeds of the gospel, and then forget about it and let the Holy Spirit take control. And then I must tell you, if you do those three things, you are going to be surprised again and again and again. Let me tell you one surprise that happened to me very briefly. In Alaska, I was only there less than 3 years, a couple weeks shy of 3 years. There was a young man who was 16 years old. He was troubled. His name was Dean Warner. I can't even remember this. He tells me this story. I invited him to go to a church conference in Juneau, Alaska, and as a result of that conference, God got a hold of his life and completely turned him around. I didn't even know it until 40-some years later. By chance, not really, I met him in Seattle, Washington, and he told me that that conference and my invitation changed his life. He is a lay preacher and a lay Bible teacher right now in the Seattle, Washington area. Can you imagine that? I never knew it. I never knew it. Now, as I close here, you remember the parable. The seed was sown on four different kinds of places, right? What percentage of that seed actually took root and reproduced? What percentage? Only 25% of the seed in that parable produced fruit. 75% did not. That's a reason for discouragement, unless you remember the other 25%. Because Jesus said the yield was amazing. I'll go with that any day. But I'll tell you, sometimes it's discouraging. Jesus has no plan B for the spreading of the gospel. You spread the gospel by the love you show, and you spread the gospel by sharing his word wherever God places you. It could be people you know. It could be complete strangers. You find your field, find it, flick it, forget about it. God bless you. My envelope. Thank you. This is one of the reasons why I have a pastor's wife here. You might wonder, hold your envelope up. Go like that. Matthew 17:20, you find it out when you go home what it is. In this envelope, don't open it now. The reason why I don't want you to open it is because there are little teeny mustard seeds from Israel in this envelope. And Jesus talked about these seeds. You find out what he says. These are for you to do whatever you wish, maybe even remind you of the power that you have with the gospel of Christ. Take them and be blessed.
Thank you so much for that message, Reverend Vermont. As we continue in our service, we managed to find this week a hymn that comes exactly from this parable, from Matthew chapter 13, and even a little bit referencing the following parable of the wheat and the weeds, which you'll hear this Sunday and next Wednesday. So would you stand with us now and sing, "Heavenly Sower, Thou Hast Scattered."
Heavenly Sower, Thou hast scattered precious seed upon Thy field, that
might be gathered, rich and fruitful in its yield. Gracious Lord, Thou hast defended this so precious seed of Thine. Nurtured, watered, guarded, tended, springing up in soil divine. Sown. Gospel rain from drought has shielded, Pentecostal winds have blown. Where Thy Son of grace in splendor, Thy seed has taken root, shed its warming rays so tender, where it blossomed into fruit. Soil, save Thy harvest from disaster. Let no foe Thy seed despoil. When upon Thy glad returning, then within Thy garner, Lord, tares and chaff are doomed to burning, may the precious wheat be stored. Heavenly sower,
as we begin to prepare our hearts for communion this evening, I encourage you to join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed, our declaration of faith. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing together in our next song, This I Believe, the Creed, taken directly from the Apostles' Creed, which we declared communally together.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating One, God Almighty, through Your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior, I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one, I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in You. Descended into darkness, You rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in You. So
hear what Jesus Christ promises. Happy are those who hunger and thirst for what is right. They shall be satisfied. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never be hungry. He who believes in me will never thirst. This is the word of the Lord. All those whom I love, I correct and discipline. Therefore, shake off your complacency and repent. See, I stand knocking at the door. If anyone listens to my voice and opens the door, I will go into his house and dine with he, and he with me. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we come before you and recognize that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, not only by what we have done, but also very possibly in what we have left undone. Lord, we ask as we come to your table that you would cleanse us, that you would cleanse us completely. We rely upon the blood of Jesus, the resurrection of Christ, his ascension to the Father, and his coming again in glory. So we pray now, Lord, that you would consecrate these elements from a common use to a holy use, that as we partake tonight, that indeed you would bless us and nourish us and equip us to do your holy will, to sow the seeds of your gospel, to love people, and to wait for the seeds to grow, as is your promise. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, you remember that in the night in which Jesus was betrayed by one he dearly loved, he took bread. And after he gave thanks for that bread, he tore it, he broke it. And he said to his disciples, "Behold, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." The deacons will come forward. Remembering that Jesus died for us, take and eat all of it. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took another chalice. There were several that he used during that meal in the upper room. This was a special chalice. Jesus said this to his disciples, "This is my blood, which is poured out for you for the remission of your sins. As often as you drink this blood, you show my death until I come. We, ministering in his name, give this to you." The psalmist says this, "Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow." There is power in the blood of Jesus to forgive us past, present, future sin. The penalty of sin is gone. Hallelujah. Drink all of it.
Now will you rise and join us in singing our last hymn?
To thee, how great and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God is Son unsparing,
sent him to die,
I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing,
bled and died
to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Let them know we are Christians by our love. Let us know that we are made whole, not by might, but by God's Spirit. Let us not be ashamed of the state of the soil of our hearts, but let us be aware that we need God's hands to make it fertile ground. Go forth in peace. Amen. Now, if you join us in our doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Please go in peace.